Right. Yep. Nice and hot. The air might not be hot, but the battery power is. We're there. All right. Well, it's good to see you guys tonight. How you doing? Good to see you. Bill, how's Kobe? You doing all right? Staying home tonight, so not feeling as good as we would like, right?
She's been a little tired last few weeks.
Sure. Okay.
Yeah?
All right. I'll ask you privately a little more details about that, but I'm glad to hear she's doing okay for now. Hi, Shana. We went through, let's see, I talked to David today, David and Kay, and she went through COVID. He's now going through a lighter version. He's not real sick with it, but he also has COVID. He's getting through that fine, but he's also got something else going on that's worrying his wife and his doctors a little bit. It's there was some numbness in the face and things that I would otherwise be alarmed to say, hey, why aren't you at the doctor concerned about stroke or something? But apparently something like this has happened before. And at the time I talked to him today, he was waiting for a call back from the doctor. I guess they have to weigh whatever his symptoms are against testing positive for COVID and all those kind of details they have to work out. I have not heard the outcome of that, the latest on that. That was this afternoon. He didn't seem terribly alarmed, but I think he was probably not trying to alarm his wife too much either, and I get that. So anyway, I'm going to pray for them tonight. And anything else? I know on a live broadcast, and by the way, welcome everybody who's watching online. Appreciate that. If you've tuned in, especially from parts unknown like Michigan City, Indiana, or from Ohio, because you thought you might find Pastor Sam preaching, if you stick with me, I appreciate that because I have big shoes to fill. But thank you for tuning in tonight. Because of some level of broadcast here, I try not to call too many last names or too many details of prayer requests. But if there's any emergency prayer requests anybody wants to share, of course, we always want to take that at this time as well. Everybody pretty healthy, wealthy, and wise? All right. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for this day. I thank you, Lord, for your love for us. Thank you, Lord, that you care for us, that you take care of us. And we pray tonight, Lord, that we just lift up David and Kay to you. And we pray, Lord, that you would help them not only to get through this case of COVID, Lord, that she had a tough time with, but has gotten through pretty much, Father, but for David with these symptoms that he's getting. I pray for if anything's hidden there, Lord, it would be revealed. And Lord, if you choose to use doctors to heal him, Lord, I pray that they would be led by the hands of God. And we pray that whatever it is, Lord, that the next report would be a good report and that he would be well and better and in your hands completely healed. And we thank you for that. Father, we pray for the word tonight, Lord. We thank you for the youth group that is not meeting tonight, but it's because they have an exciting weekend planned with this lock-in. We thank you for that. I pray for safety, pray for lots of fun and good attendance on that. Pray for the kids, Lord, that are being ministered to here tonight, Lord. I just pray you bless them and the teachers and the word as we uncover tonight. Father, I pray that it would be not only informative and faith-building, Lord, but inspirational as well, Father. And we just thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Well, as I'm going to go ahead and just say this again, I'll probably not repeat this every time, but the Lord had inspired me 12 years ago or so to preach the whole counsel of God, all of the Word of God. And he wasn't real clear that I could hear him say, I want you to preach the whole Bible or at least preach the whole New Testament. But I kind of took that as being, I'm going to start with the New Testament. I'm just going to teach all the way through and preach all the way through. And I guess when I'm done with that, I'll work on the Old Testament. Not that I'll never touch the Old Testament in the meantime, but I'm talking about a verse by verse, every doctrine, every verse, its style of teaching. And I started that before we merged two churches together back in 2012, and I preached my way through Matthew. By the time we merged, I was in the late part of Matthew. Decided to go ahead and move on, but it had taken so long to get through Matthew, I decided not to do Mark and Luke and John, since they were all kind of the same things in the Gospels. I moved on to the book of Acts. So I taught from Acts all the way through, and then instead of on Sunday mornings, I moved it to a Wednesday night format of the verse-by-verse teaching. And but continued on all the way to the book of Jude, just before Revelation. And when we got to Revelation, we changed gears and decided to go with the chart, the Dake chart that Pastor Sam taught. And we've done a lot of that over the time. So I'm getting back to preaching my way through the New Testament. Now, I'm deciding not to just pick up on Revelation because we just did that. So I'm going to go back to three other chapters, books that I have not taught in the New Testament fully, and that is books of Mark, Luke, and John. So I decided to pick John and go with the Gospel of John. Now, John is a different book than the other Gospels. The other three Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, are called synoptic Gospels. And synoptic basically means they agree with one another. That doesn't mean they disagree with John. It's just that John is written so differently and covers subjects that are so different than the other three that they call the other three synoptic and then John. Now, they claim that Mark, the book of Mark, was written first. If you remember your apostles. Anybody name all the apostles? Yeah, me either. But I can do a few. Peter and James and John and Thaddeus and some others, right? One of those things, lists I never actually memorized, but I can name most of all of them. But what we do know about all Scripture is that in the New Testament, it's all written by an apostle or inspired by an apostle with a very few exceptions. And one of those exceptions is Mark, the other is Luke. And there's, I guess, James was a brother of Jesus. Jude was a brother of Jesus. A couple that were not technically apostles, but the Lord used these to bring that prophetic word. Well, the Gospels of Mark and Luke, they say Mark was written first. And Mark was, I believe, written by a man named John Mark, who accompanied Paul and Barnabas on their missionary trips through the book of Acts. And John Mark was, I guess, famously went back home and didn't finish his first tour with them. And Paul went one way mad, and Barnabas and John Mark went the other way, and they both did even more ministry throughout the Mediterranean there. But Mark apparently compiled stories from the apostles and lived, in, obviously, in Jerusalem quite a bit, probably mostly from Peter and other apostles there, and wrote out a gospel before any of the rest of them apparently did. Now, so then they claimed that Matthew and Luke, of course, was the beloved physician. He was accompanied Paul on his missionary journeys. He wrote the book of Acts. He also wrote the gospel of Luke. But all of those stories, he was not an apostle either. He was a younger than that generation by some years, and he accumulated stories as well, and was, in his own words, set in order those things which I've heard and from the apostles, and he wrote an orderly story of the gospels that he picked up from the apostles. So it was still apostolic teaching. And then the book of, the irony is they say that Matthew, the apostle, kind of copied a lot of what Mark wrote, word for word. And I think it might have been the other way around. Mark may have written his gospel first, but there are stories that say that Matthew actually wrote his gospel first in Hebrew. Actually, some claim it was Aramaic. And then later we get the Greek version of Matthew. And the significance of that is that Matthew was not only a tax collector, but he probably had the ability to write shorthand, and that was common in the day, and was very well educated and very versed at writing things really quickly. And he may have actually had the first written eyewitness accounts of what Jesus said that were like written in shorthand. I mean, like in real time. It's almost like recording the Sermon on the Mount, that he would have done that. And then used those notes later to write his gospel, his full gospel in Greek later. Could be those early notes were used by Luke and by Mark to be able to write their versions, because they had to get source material from somewhere. I think they got it from Matthew, and that Matthew's the source of all that. But with all that aside, move into Book of John. Now, John wrote the book of John, the Gospel of John, later, a little bit later than the others, later in life. Probably because it was like, hey, you're getting older, John, it's time to write down what you know, write down what you feel. Under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he begins the book of John completely different. I'm sure by now he's read Matthew's account, he's read Mark and Luke's account of the gospel, but he decides that under the Lord's inspiration, he's going to write his own gospel, the gospel according to John. And while John does not contradict the others, it has a great number of stories that are not in the other synoptic gospels, or a good amount of them, and he does not contain many of the stories you do find in the others, so they all complement one another, the four gospels together. So we start in John chapter 1. He takes a fresh approach. He's not just talking so much historically about the historic Jesus. He's not just talking about like Matthew, he spoke to the Jews about their Messiah. That was kind of the approach of Matthew. Mark and Luke were more of a Greek-speaking, wider audience type of people, but they showed Jesus as the servant. They showed Jesus as, I forget the other comparison that one of the Gospels makes. One's a servant, there's like the eagle and the cow and these different symbols they've used. But either way, John, when you get to the book of John, he shows, really emphasizes that Jesus is the Son of God, the deity of Christ, and the universal appeal of Christ to the nations, to all, not just to the Jews like Matthew, and not just as the servant, not just as the other thing, but as the Son of God. And so he starts out totally different and begins John chapter 1 and verse 1, has a very familiar sounding phrase, in the beginning. In the beginning. And of course, where have we heard that before? Genesis chapter 1 verse 1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form, am I? And so that same approach he says, he begins here and he says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And so begins that amazing passage here. So we've talked about Genesis chapter 1 verse 1, in the beginning. The beginning of what? The beginning of creation is what that's talking about. Did God exist before he created heaven and earth? Yeah. Now, to use the term before implies time, which he invented, by the way. Time and space, we've learned in the 20th century and following, that through Einstein's research, that time and space are inextricably connected together, that somehow gravity that we can't explain, and time, which can be bent and stretched and so forth, apparently, and space, which can be bent and stretched by gravity, and all that stuff is somehow interconnected in ways that I couldn't begin to really explain or understand, are all part of the creation. And so God, who is in eternity past, is how we say it, a timeless place, if you will, created a creation that includes time and space and gravity and all the matter and the creation that we begin there with. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. I'm sorry, I'm just going to take off. Something's alarming me on my wrist, and I'm done with being distracted by it. My apologies if I distracted you. But it's in the beginning, so it's the beginning of time. Beginning of time is what we're talking about here. So in the beginning of time, it says, was the Word. Now we have to establish who the Word is, and we find in verse 14 that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. So we know that the Word is Jesus, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. But he's being described here in his pre-incarnate state. In other words, before he became born in Bethlehem as Jesus of Nazareth, or Jesus born in Bethlehem and then later in Nazareth, he's talking about God, where John is showing that Christ predated Mary's womb, that he existed as who he is even before he took on flesh and became Jesus as we understand him, the way he interacted with us. He's like, this great man Jesus is not just a great man, but he's actually the Son of God. In fact, he goes so far as to say he is God in this context here. In the beginning was the Word. At the beginning of creation was he already. He previously existed even before that. Was the Word, and the Word was with God. And the Word was God. So let me look at the Word was with God comments for a sec, first of all here. In look at Romans chapter 9 and verse 5. And I have not marked these places, so I'm going to have to do my best to race you to those places. Acts, Romans. Romans chapter 9 and verse 5. It says, of whom are the fathers, and from whom, according to the flesh, Christ came, who is over all, the eternally blessed God. Amen. So this is a passage where Paul's describing Jesus, and he describes him saying that he came from the Israelites. That was the fathers of the Jews. It says, of whom are the fathers, and from whom those Israeli fathers, whom according to the flesh, Christ came. Now, he doesn't just call him Jesus. Jesus, Christ, Jesus is the Son of God, but he specifically is calling him as Christ because Christ is the anointed one, the one that was promised from the Father in the Old Testament that would come, something bigger than just a baby born in Bethlehem, but the one, the one. Christ came, according to the flesh, who is over all and the eternally blessed God. So Paul calls Christ God in this case specifically. And now that is a, according to Jehovah's Witnesses, that is an incorrect, assumption error that he is not God, that he is maybe a God or deity, but he's not the God because, you know, at some point God created Jesus. And John's being pretty clear here that no, before anything was ever created, before there was anything, in the beginning was already the Word. And so I also want to look at 1 John chapter 1 and verse 1. The same Gospel of John writer, the Apostle John, also wrote 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John toward the back of your Bible. And he begins 1 John chapter 1, very similarly, and let's see, I'm sorry, James, Peter, 1 John. And he says that, in 1 John chapter 1 and verse 1, he says, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled concerning the word of life. So he's talking about Christ. He says, my eyes have seen him, my hands have handled him, I have interacted with this Jesus that I'm describing here. And he says, I'm telling you about this concerning the word of life. He could have said Jesus, but he didn't say Jesus. He said the word of life, because as John says in his gospel here, the word preceded, Jesus. Actually, it's the same person, if you will, but he was called the Word even before he was called Jesus. So he says, these that our hands have handled concerning the word of life, the life was manifested, and we have seen and bear witness and declare to you that eternal life which was with the Father and manifested to us, that which we have seen and heard we declare to you, that you may also have fellowship with us, and truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And these things are written to you that your joy may be full. So he not only establishes that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, he also establishes that Jesus is called the Word of Life here. So going back to John chapter 1 and verse 1, it's consistent with him saying in the beginning was already the Word. Now, Revelation chapter 19 and verse 13, and by the way, I'm putting a lot of extra scriptures with this one half of one verse, I know, but it is such a foundational and amazing verse. John chapter 1 is, and verse 1 in particular, that it's worth the extra time. So Revelation 19:13, where are we going next? I remember the old days when my pastor would get quiet and start turning pages, and then he would make some comment about how he loved to hear those pages turn. And I can't do that anymore because we have electronic Bibles, and we're like, boom, we're right there ahead of you. Revelation 19 and verse 13 says he was clothed. Well, I'm going to back up to verse 11. It describes the second coming of Christ. It says, now I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire. Now, we're talking about Christ here. So just compare and contrast between the Christ of the rest of the Gospels, you know, the Jesus of Nazareth, compared to this description. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called Jesus of Nazareth. Oh, I'm sorry, I read that wrong, didn't I?
Yeah,
he's called the Word of God, because this Word of God state of being that Christ is the powerful God form of the man, Jesus Christ. It is one of those head scratchers that everybody needs to theologically believe if you're going to be a good doctrinal Christian conform, but yet everybody still doesn't. It's hard to wrap your head around the fact that Jesus Christ was fully man and fully God. I joke with my youth pastor who went through our Bible college training, who was trying to defend the faith and to someone else, and said that, no, you don't understand. Jesus was half man, half God. I'm like, well, that sounds great, but that's actually heresy, you know? So I got to dig one in there. I think it's the only thing I've really caught him on doctrinally that was wrong, and he corrected it right away. But Jesus Christ was not half God. He was all God. And Jesus Christ was not half man. He's all man. And so Jesus the Christ is Jesus the Word. The Word came first. Jesus of Nazareth was born in Bethlehem in 4 BC, some say. But he is eternally both God and man from now on. There was a time when he was not man, but there's never been a time that he was not God. And that's the important lesson of it here. So he is called, his name is called, John, who was very familiar with Jesus of Nazareth, called him in this case the Word of God. And the army, by the way, same John that wrote Book of Revelation, also wrote 1 John, also wrote the Gospel of John. So the same author throughout all these three places consistently. I love the rest of the description there. It says, and the armies in heaven, clothed with fine linen, white and clean, followed him out on white horses. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that he should with it strike the nations, and he himself will rule them with the rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness of the and wrath of Almighty God. And he has on his robe and on his name a thigh written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I'm not sure how theologically that connected to the rest of what we're talking about, but it just sounds so cool I had to read it again. That's our Jesus. That's who we worship. So I want to also read John chapter 17, the book of John, 17 and verse 5. And the last place we'll look according to, for this particular section. John 17:5 says, and now, O Father, glorify me together with yourself. These are Jesus' own words as he's praying to the Father. And now, O Father, glorify me together with yourself with the glory which I had with you before the world was. So this is before, in the beginning, he already was. And Jesus is saying, would you now glorify me with the glory that I shared with you before the world was? And I think we got a picture of what that glory looks like in Revelation a while ago. And the apostles got to see a little glimpse of it on the Mount of Transfiguration. When on the Mount of Transfiguration, he suddenly took on a glow and a brightness that they couldn't even look at for its brightness. And the flesh was still there, but they could no longer even see that form. All they could see was the brightness of this presence that was with them. He literally transformed in front of them into this being of light. And of course, he is light. And so that's the glory that he was talking about there. So in the beginning was the Word was with God. Now let's look at this part, and the Word was God. I could bore you with terms from Greek that I have actually forgotten the actual names of, but the gist of it is this, that there's this, in the Greek you'll find the lettering, it says, and the Word was with God, and God was the Word. And there's, why is it written that way when everybody translates it as the Word was God? By the way, everybody, every translation of the Bible translates the Word was God, with the exception of the Jehovah's Witnesses, who say that the Word was a God. The word a, the indefinite article a, is not, does not exist in Old Greek, in ancient Greek. So to add the word a is actually something you would have to add in by the translator. And so it can even be dishonest if it's stuck in there where it shouldn't be, which I believe the Jehovah's Witnesses translators of the Bible did do. It just isn't there. There's no word a. So therefore, the word was God, not the word was a God. Just it says straight up, the word was God. There are a few different ways to explain why this is. Some people say that the word was God. God was the word. They put the in front of word because it's the subject of the word, you know, verse and blah, blah, blah. All kinds of opinions out there as to why these things are. But everybody universally agrees, except for those who don't believe in the deity of Christ, that it says just what it says. That John was very intentional, that he chose his words carefully, and that it was grammatically correct in Greek, if not in English, to write it exactly word for word the way he did. And the translation is, you know, if you could understand Greek very, very well and become a master of it, you would come up with no other conclusion than what Paul wrote for you conveniently, what John wrote for us, now translated conveniently in English, the word was God. So Jesus is God, as he has been shown in a few places, but most specifically here. So, it says, and he was in the beginning with God. Did I go to Romans 9:5 already? I think I did, yeah. So let me move on to verse, he was in the beginning with God, which was because he was already there. Verse 3, all things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. So, how many things were made by him?
Everything.
All things, right? So, if all things were made through him, if everything, does that mean that every created thing was made by him? Everything in the creation was made by him.
Yeah.
That's what it says, right? Okay, so then if the Jehovah's Witnesses are right and Jesus is the first created being, then did Jesus create himself? No, because all things in creation were made by him, but he existed before creation. He was there already. So this just goes on to prove the deity of Christ, that all things were made through him. The word made there basically means to come into being, which did not exist before. So he couldn't have created himself. So all things that were created were made through him, made through him. And without him, nothing was made that was made. So not only did he create everything, it also says there's no exceptions. There are no exceptions to this, that everything was made by him. Now, if we go back to Genesis chapter 1 again, we find that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, right? So who, according to Genesis, created heaven and earth? Okay, now earth is here. If you saw this week, did anybody see this week the picture of the Hubble that showed the deep field thing there? Excuse me, not Hubble, but the new James Webb telescope that shows that the newest deep field picture image that was just released shows the extreme distances of the universe. All those things were created by God in the beginning. Now, I won't even get into in this discussion, I love this stuff, and I'm going to stay away from the whole, how old was it? Was it 13.5 billion years ago? They're measuring distance. Light years is a measure of distance, not time. And so I won't even get into that. But how are 13.5 billion years, light years distant objects and more are being showed here? And God created all of those things. That's the heavens. And then here's the earth. So in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That's pretty much everything in the universe. The known universe and the not known universe, he created everything. So there are no exceptions. And John, again, of course, goes on to say there are no exceptions, that without him was not anything made that was made. And yet we see here in verse 3, it says, all things were not made by him, but it says, but through him. So now you have this like, well, wait a minute, who did creating? Was it the Father creating through the Son? Seems to be what this is saying. Or was it that God created through Jesus. Oh, wait, Jesus is God. So then you run into that thing, you know. And the, at the end of the day, he's throwing down two very amazing concepts. One is that there is a Trinity, and that the Father creating through the Son was not what happened. All things were created through the Son, and even says by him and for him in other places. So Jesus did the creating, or excuse me, the Word, which we know as Jesus, did the creating. But yet Genesis chapter 1 says God created. And yet we find that Jesus is the Son of God. So which is it? Well, now we're back to a discussion of the Trinity again. But it just reinforces itself. And I'm not going to try to take you down a confusing rabbit trail of that again, just to say that this person, Jesus, that hung out with John, that his hands handled and his eyes saw, was so much more awesome than what he revealed about himself on the earth. That he was so much more than just the miracle worker. He was so much more than the kind shepherd. He was so much more than the comforting preacher. He was God himself in all of its glory. And John begins with that this declaration here in John 1. All things made through him, without him nothing was made that was made. I'm going to take a quick look here at Colossians chapter 1, verses 16 and 17. And this kind of reinforces this concept as well. Colossians 1. I'm going to start in verse 15. It says, he, talking about Christ, he is the image of the invisible God. Now, can you take a picture of God? First of all, you can't see him, right? And therefore, your camera can't see him. You can't get him on your cell phone. You can't take a selfie with God. But since we can't photograph God here, it says here that he, Jesus, is the image or the picture of the invisible God. The word image there means the exact image. Like the New Testament, I believe Jesus himself says, no man has seen God at any time. Well, if we've not seen God, then what does God look like? Well, we don't know because it's a spirit. Oh, wait, he looks like Jesus. How do we know? Not only because Jesus is described as being God, but it says here that he is the image of the invisible God. He's the face of God, if you will. The image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. Firstborn here doesn't mean he was suddenly born, although he was in Bethlehem, of course, as a human. But it means firstborn, meaning having all authority and power as the grown adult son in the home of a household. He's the Prince Charles, only with more power. You think of Prince Charles being the monarch of England. He's actually just the prince. He's the up and coming. The queen is the one who has the authority, such as they have in modern monarchies. But in those kingdoms, he doesn't have much power as a prince, but he will only have power when he becomes the king. But this firstborn notion means that he has all authority as if he were the one. It's not unlike, I hate to go back to and appeal to the Godfather movie again, but if you saw the Godfather movie, you see at one point Michael Corleone becomes the heir apparent. He becomes the new Godfather, and he becomes the new Godfather before the old man dies. And the old man is clearly the power. He's clearly the authority. He's clearly the one to put all these things together. But the son, Michael, is the firstborn as far as power goes. And he carries all the decisions that are rubber stamped by the father because they are in complete unity in their crime lifestyle. But it's somewhat of a picture that we might describe that Jesus is, as the Son of God, fully in control of the house, and he has full ultimate authority over all things, and so forth. There is no distinction between father and son as far as authority. They are distinct persons because one loves the other and one begot the other, so to speak, but there is no difference in authority. And so he is the firstborn over all creation. Again, I'm in Colossians 1, starting verse 16 now. It says, for by him all things were created. Now, in this case, it doesn't say through him. It says literally by him. All things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, both visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created through him and for him. Now, this carries the idea of Jesus, the creator, even a step further. Because when we say that Jesus created all things, including heaven and earth, as is referenced back in Genesis 1:1, we think of the heavens, like we talked about in the picture from the deep field image of the James Webb telescope, and we think of the earth and everything that we know of on the earth. And we think of all creation and everything in the universe. But in the universe is only what we can measure with our five senses: sight, sound, touch, and so forth, and the instruments that we can create to think of more. Is there more to creation than just heaven and earth as the universe? What? Spirit world. Yeah, all the angelic host, all of whatever is described as heaven, is all beyond the scope of the universe. So when we find that he created all of heaven and all of earth, all of the universe and the earth as we know it, that's pretty impressive. That means he is the creator of all created beings and therefore is worthy of our worship and our praise. But then we go on to find out that he not only created all those things, it wasn't like there was a big party in heaven and a bunch of angels and a hierarchy and streets of gold and all kinds of stuff going on up there. And then they got together and said, hey, let's make this creation, this heaven and earth thing, and we'll let it all happen through Jesus. No, he even created all of the angelic hosts. He is the creator of all things, according to this passage here, because it says, for by him all things were created that are in heaven, you think of the universe, and that are on earth, which includes the earth as we know it. But he says also, visible and invisible. You say, well, maybe he's talking about the electromagnetic spectrum and electricity that you can't see. But it says, whether thrones or dominions or powers or principalities. That's consistent with what Paul talks about and the spirit world, the principalities and powers with which we wrestle in the spirit world. These are demons and angels, and everything that was ever created also is included in this. Not just the known universe, but also the things in the spirit world. We're all created by him. Whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created through him. There's that word through again. And for him. So verse 16 starts off saying that by him all things were created, and then it closes up by saying all things were created through him and for him. So the mind of God chose through the person of Jesus Christ, the Word, to create heaven and earth. So therefore it's through him and by him. And it's also for him. We think of the government of our own documents, the government of the people, by the people, for the people. Well, all of creation was created of Jesus, by Jesus, and for Jesus. He is before all things. Doesn't even say he was before all things, but he is, as in the great I am, the one that answered Moses and said, tell him, I am has sent you. I am is the word, the Hebrew word for Yahweh, from which we get Jehovah. It is the name of the covenant God. He is before all things. He is Yahweh before all things were created. And he is in the present, ever present state, is before all things. And in him all things consist. In him all things consist. This world wants to do away with Jesus. It really does. And we used to say that, preachers used to say that when I was younger, and the older I get, the more it has just simply accelerated. Christianity is an inconvenience that's in the way of evolutionary teaching. Christianity is an inconvenience in the way of the world's morality. And it is becoming something that if you really believe and are a real Christian, that you're going to be on the outs with society. So society wants to get rid of Jesus, but if you really get rid of Jesus, everything disintegrates, according to this verse. It says, by him all things hold together, consist. It is the natural state of matter to disperse. Now I'm just talking about matter in the universe. Natural is to just disperse. If you spray an aerosol into space, it just continuously spreads out. If you release any kind of water into space, it just spreads out. The only thing that would ever call it back together is gravity, which, by the way, was created by God. But the tendency is to spread out, but he says that that which holds things together at the subatomic level or whatever, however smart we get to learn the terminology it would describe creation, the consistency that holds things together is Jesus. Now, I'm not going to try to impress you that I know a lot about physics at the subatomic level, because I don't, but I'm just one of those weirdos that I love science and I just dig into everything I can about it. And one thing I've learned is that there are two explanations as to how the heavens and the earth work. There's the grand scheme that they understand that everything's held together by gravity, and Einstein describes that in his first and second laws of his papers on relativity. And at the subatomic level, the molecules and the atoms hold themselves together with neutrons, photons, electrons, which is all they had when I was a kid, and now they've discovered things be the subatomic particles, quarks with switches that go up and down and spin and all kinds of crazy things that I can't really accurately describe because I don't fully understand. But there's not enough gravity to hold an atom together. There's not enough mass to create enough gravity to hold it together. And yet it still does. And they don't really know why it does. As part of the studies, that's why they continue to dig and dig and dig and try to understand, split atoms apart and look at them and try to figure out what's going on with them. Because what explains orbits and stars and moons and things that orbit around themselves and galaxies that swirl, all those things don't translate to the smallest levels. So they're looking for a grand unified description, a theory that will explain all the microscopic all the way up to the size of the universe. But they can't do it yet. And I just snicker at that, because they may finally find that explanation, they might come up with it. But as long as they don't, I just snicker at this verse that says that by him all things consist. What is holding this atom together? It's not gravity. There's not enough mass there. Well, according to this, the one who created it says, I made it, I'll hold it together. And when you finally get rid of me, I'll let go. There is no consistency. There is no creation without Jesus Christ. Even if they find what actually holds those little atoms together, it doesn't matter, because spiritually he's the author and finisher of it all. He's the one who created it. He designed it. He understands it. Nothing was made without him. And according to this, by him, all things continue to consist. And he is the head of the body of the church, which it goes on there, and that's getting off subject there. But this is the extent, the magnitude, the power of this Christ that we're talking about here. So back to John chapter 1 and verse 4. Says, in him was life. In him was life. Oh my gosh, change of gears. Get out of the science for a minute. I dig the science, not everybody does. Most people don't. Now let's talk about something where it hits home. Let's talk about something that appeals to the right brain a little bit, the emotional side of us. In him was life. Not just technical life, but life in every description as we would describe it in English. Not only biological life, but spiritual life. Not only spiritual life and consciousness and awareness, but quality of life. When we say something has life, that's always universally interpreted as a positive thing. There's life in that system. He is life. Now, let alone the fact that they have never found anywhere in the solar system or beyond any indication that there's actual life of any kind anywhere. Not only have they found that the uniqueness of planet Earth is really unique, and that of the billions of stars out there, they've only found a few that even are sitting in the right positions that might even have liquid water on the planet and an atmosphere with oxygen, let alone have any life on it. I mean, if they found something out there beyond our world that was as amazing as Mars. Mars has rocks, it has an atmosphere, it may have had liquid water at one time, and not a speck, not a microbe, not a cold organization of life anywhere, ever, as far as we can tell. Now, if one day we go to Mars and we start finding that there was some kind of fossilized proof that there was life there, okay, God made that too. That doesn't bother my faith one bit. But isn't it astounding to put it in the words of Carl Sagan, who was a famous evolutionary thinking astrophysicist who was fascinated with the universe, complete heathen, totally didn't believe in God at all. But he said, one of two things is true. Either there's life out there and we are not alone, or we are completely alone in the universe. He says, either thought is staggering. And he's right. If there is other life out there, that's amazing, staggering. God is so amazing and created all of these things. Or there's no other life except the uniqueness of planet Earth. And that God only made life in this vast universe here. Either way is astounding. Either way, it points back to God. Either way, poor Carl Sagan missed the boat on the full comprehension of the understanding of the value of knowing him who created the universe is also called life. He is the way, the truth, and the life. John 14:6. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by him. In him, verse 4, was life, and the life was the light of men. Light is universally considered a positive thing in our culture, every culture on earth. Darkness is always considered something that is ignorant. It's always considered something that is, you don't know the way. It's something that doesn't have warmth, it doesn't have life to it. Darkness is never considered, maybe shade darkness is about as good as anything can be positive about the dark. But light is always considered positive. Light is always considered illumination of knowledge. It's always considered warmth. It's always considered health. It's always considered positive things when it's talked about. Now, it doesn't say heat. Heat can be very destructive, but it says he in him was life, and the life was the light of men. The world is dark. The world is a dark, dark place. And when he, the light, comes into us, not only is he the life, which is so refreshing and appeals to my emotional self as well as my intellectual self, but he is also light. Life and light. I'll take a big dose of both. It's what my dog enjoys when she lays out in the backyard on winter days and just lays in the yard when we've let the house get too cold, and she just soaks her bones out there in the warm sun. And she just walks outside and just follows it over the grass and just lays there and rolls over and just soaks in the light and soaks in the life that is a creation. That's the impression I get as I read this. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And boy, do us men need some light. The verse 5 says, and the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. Now, first of all, there are some versions of the Bible that say the light, that word comprehend means like extinguish or could not put it out. And truly, the light cannot be put out by the darkness. That is true. The word for comprehend there or whatever, destroyed or put out, it comes from a word that means to like snatch, to catch, to grab up. And if you think of the context here, that could be that light cannot overcome. See, if you grab something out of the air, if you snatch something up, you have, if you're a predator and prey situation, you have controlled that situation. You have, what's the word? Basically, you've become in command of that situation. Light cannot be extinguished or overcome by darkness. That is true. But I believe that that word there that is translated as comprehended is probably what it really means here. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. Let me look at verse 10, jump ahead to verse 10 just for a moment. Verse 10 says, He was in the world, and the world was made through Him, and the world did not know Him. The world did not know Him. They could not, it's like the Son of God, the Creator of heaven and earth, walks among us. The one who is in His glorious state, fire comes out of His eyes, and He glows in the dark, and He's powerful, and He's all these things that we've described here. And yet He walked among men, and they had no idea of who they were dealing with. Pilate had no idea that he really didn't have authority over Jesus' life. He had no idea. He knew he was a good guy. He didn't want to put him to death, but he had no idea what he was dealing with. No idea at all. So he truly did not comprehend Christ. And so it is, I believe that that's really what it means here in verse 5, when it says, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. Could not even comprehend it. It is the grace of God that we can be saved. It is the grace of God that God allows us to comprehend the dark state in which we are in. There are caves in the earth that some of our children have actually visited this summer, go deep in the earth, and inevitably on every cave tour I've ever been on, there's that moment when the leader of the troop always stops everybody, turns off all lights, and goes to pitch black for a moment so that you can comprehend the depth of the darkness of a cave. In those places, if you're not too deep in the cave, are little critters that are blind. And they don't see, and they don't have any idea how blind they are, because they have never seen light until somebody came through with a light on their forehead or a flashlight. They only function in the dark. They understand their environment by touch and by smell and by other means, but not vision. They don't know how blind they are. There are versions of those same animals on the surface. There are blind fish in caves. There are blind, I don't know, bugs and junk. I don't even want to, I'm not that much of an entomologist to be able to say. But they don't even know how blind they are, because they've never been exposed to the light. See? So he came into the world here in verse 5. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness does not even comprehend it. They have no idea how in the dark they are. And so only the grace of God allows you and I, us little cave-dwelling, darkness-dwelling creatures who had no spiritual life in us, whose spirits were all described as being dead since our first sin, or since Adam's first sin. We were born as triune body, soul, and spirit, and the spirit was basically dead. And there was no communication with God that was of any value. There was no spiritual connection until the Holy Spirit at your salvation came and saved you and made you new and made you alive in the Spirit again. So we were creatures crawling around in darkness, having no idea how dark the darkness was, because we had eyes, but not eyes that could see. We had ears, but not ears that could hear. We could understand that there was such a thing called love and still not comprehend God's love. We could have minds that could understand faithfulness and cruelty and love and self-sacrifice and jealousy and hatred and rage. And we thought we knew what our environment was until we met the light. Until the light of Christ enlightens your soul, you will never really know life. But once the light is on, once the light of Christ invades your soul, once you begin to comprehend the beauty, the power, the enormity of who Christ is in your life, in the Word, in the world around you, you will never be the same. You will never crawl in your bug cave
the same ever again. You will know that there is a world out there, that there is light out there, that there is so much more grand out there than in this little bug cave in which we crawl around until He comes. There's so much more to life. And He is the light of men. Thank God for Him. Yeah. All right, in the last few minutes here, I want to just cover the next couple of verses here. Verse 6 says, "There was a man sent from God whose name was John." Just for clarification, let me clarify that the John in this description is John the Baptist, not to be confused with John the Apostle who's writing this. John the Baptist never wrote any of the Bible, but he's written about in the Bible, and John the Apostle is writing about John the Baptist. And most of the time, if not all the time, John the Apostle never uses the name John describing himself. It's always the apostle whom Jesus loved, or the disciple that Jesus loved, or something like that. But he says, "There was a man from God whose name was John. This man came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all through him might believe." Now, this is already an amazing place, because in verse 5, it says, "The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it." It says in verse 4, "In him was life, and the life was the light of men," that Jesus himself is that great light of the world. And yet, all of this was revealed to the world, not through Madison Avenue tactics, not through the latest release of someone's album, not through the internet blitzing of commercial information, not on a special television show for all that, but simply through a preacher named John. So all this amazingness of God himself coming to earth in the form of Jesus Christ, walking on the earth, which is stunningly amazing that God would be with us, is all out there. And that great tour, if you will, if it was a rock band, it'd be the launch of a great tour, city by city, is all launched by a weirdo preacher who wore camel skins and ate bugs and preached in the nondescript areas, out of the mainstream, out of the big cities, out in the woods, in the wilderness, a guy named John the Baptist. And he was the one, verse 6, verse 7, "This man came for a witness, to bear witness of the light." The light was in the world, but John was the one who was supposed to prepare the way. That's just amazing to me that God would be so, quote unquote, foolish as to think that this was a good plan. And yet he doesn't stop there. God didn't learn his lesson, quote unquote. He picked us to continue to spread the light, to continue to spread the message. Looking around at this huge crowd in here, it's up to us to bear his light to the world. At least we have cars and television and cell phones and other means that John the Baptist didn't have. All he had was a pair of lungs and a willingness to be used of God. "This man came as a witness, to bear witness of the light." See, how am I doing on time here? I got a couple of minutes. "To bear witness of the light," like we are, "that all through him," not through John, but through Jesus. I cannot do that. Sorry about that. "Through him might believe." That all through him, Jesus, might believe. "He was not that light," John was not, "but was sent to bear witness of that light." So John the Baptist is his birth and his the story of the miraculous conception, not immaculate conception, but it was a miraculous birth of John, in that his parents were very old and had a child late in life. And that story is a tremendous story. It's found in another gospel, but that's all it says about it right here. John has a tendency to jump right into the story and keep going. "But he was not that light, but he himself said, 'Nope, I'm not that light.' The Pharisee said, 'Are you him? Are you the Savior? Are you the one we're looking for?' He's like, 'Nope, nope, nope, I'm not him,' but he's coming." And at some point then says, there he is. Verse 9 says, that was the true light which gives light to every man coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. We've talked about that. Verse 11 and 12 says, he came to his own, and his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name. Now, I'm going to stop there tonight. I want to go into the book of Romans and unfold that a little bit more. But just the first reading of that is amazing. He came unto his own, and his own did not receive him. But as many as did receive him, that would be you and I, to them, to us, he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name. A couple things there. First of all, I didn't have the right before he offered it. I had no right to be called the Son of God. He gave the right to be called the sons of God. Rights are something we think we have inherited. All men are created equal, and we were born with these rights. Well, this is a right that was imputed. This is a right that was given by God. The requirement for the giving of the right to be called the Son of God is simply that we believe on him. But as many as received him and believed on him, to them he gave the right to be called the Son of God. Once that right is given to you, it cannot be taken away. Satan sees all the bugs in the cave, but some of them are starting to light up. Some of them look like lightning bugs. Some of them have the light within them now. Some of them can no longer be called creatures of darkness. And that right to be called the Son of God cannot be taken away from you once you become a Christian. What a marvelous truth that you are children of the light, have been born into his family, and have the right to be called the sons of God. Awesome thing. All right, I guess we're out of time. Any last-minute comments or anything on that or questions? By the way, I just want to make this always true. If anybody has any questions, you know, stump the pastor type questions or something you always wanted to know, I'll try to make time for those in Wednesday nights anyway. For any question, not only on the text we're on, but anything. So we'll just take a couple minutes for that. All right, well, with that, let's just pray. Lord, we thank you for your word tonight. We thank you for the great insight that John provided for us in the gospel, that you have cared about us enough to reveal to us. Lord, we had no idea how dark our lives were without you. We were not able to comprehend that. But Lord, you have helped us through the knowledge of your word to comprehend who is Christ and who we are in your plan. And we thank you, Lord, for saving us. And thank you for giving us the right to become the sons of God. And we just are so grateful for that. Help us, Lord, to, like John, be bear witness of that light to a dark world that really needs to know something more than the darkness that they're wandering in. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Well, thank you guys for coming tonight. We'll see you Sunday.